eSportBets.com – уникальное место для настоящего геймера. Только здесь возможны ставки на киберспортивные события. Ты знаешь толк в самых популярных играх и готов рисковать? Смотри регулярные трансляции и зарабатывай реальные деньги. eSportBets.com – живой азарт и холодный расчет.
So welcome back, everybody. We are ready with the final game of the evening. It's going to be Reason Gaming versus Navi. And I actually think they're not even called Reason anymore, are they, Ven? They're Uno Ein, right?
Uno Ein.
Yeah, so I tweeted at Reason Gaming as well, because I just apparently can't remember a thing. But it's not Reason Gaming any longer. Although I'm wondering what would happen if the whole community just decided to keep calling it. Do you think Reason would eventually just surrender and say, all right, fine, you know, we're going to pick them up anyway?
Who knows? Might be. I mean, the lineup on paper looks pretty good, so I wouldn't be too surprised if they found themselves an organization like Reason.
Be nice.
You know, in a couple of weeks' time. But for now, they're Uno Ein. I'm not really sure what the Uno part stands for, but I know A-I-N is for awesome is nothing.
Yeah, so you need us, awesome is nothing.
Oh, yeah. That's the right, you need us.
So someone told me that, and I still didn't really understand. And
that's like a plea. It's a plea to all the organizations without a team. You need us.
All right. Well, I mean, this team just beat ESC 16-3, I think. A complete slaughter, where I heard PNX dropped like 30 kills in like 30 seconds or something. He just killed everyone on the whole map. And that was pretty impressive. I think that was on Dust 2 as well. And ESC is you know, the Polish team, and they are actually not that bad, I would say. They did pretty well in the qualifiers and everything. So overall, I think, you know, that's a bit upsetting, but they're still going to be playing Navi here, which is a different caliber, and I think, I'm not sure if it's going to be a Mirage. That's what we're showing right here, but I think Navi's asking for a 5-minute break, which I kind of understand if Navi need a 5-minute break, because, I mean, Vendetta, what did we just witness?
We saw Christ J, the risening of Christ J.
The utter redemption, the redeemer, basically.
Jesus Christ J Superstar.
Can we do that? Can we give him that name? Chris J the Redeemer? I guess if we keep calling him Christ J, we're going to get in trouble with weird religious organizations, but maybe just Chris J the Redeemer?
We might as well do it until, you know, okay, Westboro comes at us.
Well, if they come at us, I'm not sure I'm really going to worry that much. If somebody politely said it, maybe they'll be different, but I don't know. Westboro, I don't have a lot of respect for.
I hope a lot of people don't.
We'll go with either Christ J or Chris J the Redeemer. One of those two is definitely a good name for him. That was a really... I mean, and the funny thing is, we sort of said it early on. You pointed out that it's either, you know... you said Alu has to go Alu mode and Chris J has to go Chris J mode. And suddenly Chris J delivered, and Alu didn't even have a bad game. He didn't go full Alu. He kept it on the back burner, you know. He was just ready and waiting. If Chris was going to burn out, then maybe Alu was going to be ready.
Yeah, pretty much. But yeah, what I'm really excited about after seeing that game is, you know, MassWars is obviously going to G3 as well. And if they bring that kind of play to London, then holy hell, what a tournament that's going to be.
I really hope they will. I've been saying for a very long time, maybe people are going to get tired of listening to me say, but I feel like the one thing that we're missing in this game, apart from the Asian scene, the Brazilian scene, we really need to see a top German team. I feel like we can't go on any longer without having a top 3 or 4 German team, and there has to be a combination of German players out there that can make this happen, or there has to be newcomers to the scene that can make it happen, because German Counter-Strike has a really long and proud history, so it's a real shame that we're not seeing it yet. One day it's going to happen, I'm sure. I feel like it's bound to happen, I imagine.
yeah, you're actually right, yeah. What do you think? Well, obviously you mentioned that Reason, or I'm sorry, Uno Ein beat ESC just now. So what do you really see, or what do you expect from this team going up against Navi?
Well, it looks like the map switched to Dust 2, so I'm just going to make sure. So map is Dust 2, so now we know the map. So this is the map that that Reason or Uno Ein went completely nuts on and beat ESC 16-3. Now, because of the way that Dust2 plays, I can't really read too much into that result. It could just be that Reason, you know, got the first 8 rounds in a row, and then ESC couldn't mentally come back from it, and they also had, you know, maybe PNX had the game of his life. And so I wouldn't say that based on that result we can say something about this game. But what I would say is that I know Kevin from the Uno Iron team is a really good AWPer.
Yeah,
and
Kevin.
Yeah, if he can come out on top against Guardian, who hasn't had the best couple of games here today in the SLTV Star Series, I mean, if that happens, yeah, I mean, especially if Navi is as rattled from the game as we think they might be, I can see a chance that maybe there could be another upset here, definitely.
Mm. I'm actually really excited to see Kevin play CSGO again. Because actually, it's kind of funny that they're playing versus Navi and Guardian, because Kevin versus Guardian in Source was one of the most fun op battles to watch. Kevin has a really very special style of play as an opper, and it's just super exciting to watch. He's kind of similar to Chris J in a lot of ways, which I know a lot of people like to watch. And if he can, you know, find his way in Source, because he still hasn't played a lot of CSGO, but if he gets into the groove of things, he's going to be an incredibly scary player. I think he has something like 600 hours in CSGO, which nothing compared to all the other people on the server. And that just kind of tells you what kind of talent he has for the game, because, yeah, he's just that good. And he has the potential to be even better.
Yeah, well, yeah. I mean, if it really happens, that's certainly going to be pretty amazing. I guess we do have a share of good Danish AWPers as well. Nico comes to mind.
Yeah. Nico, good. Pimp, Kerrigan, Freeze. I mean, the list goes on. Glaive as well knows how to handle an AWP.
Where is Freeze? That's a good question.
Yeah, Freeze kind of... He never announced his retirement or anything, so I just assume
he's
still around.
I'm kind of glad he didn't, because sometimes it gets a little bit boring listening to pro players saying, I'm going to retire, and then they come back 2 weeks. Exactly.
Yeah.
And so, I mean, I understand if you really seriously, I just, you know, it's the sort of thing where I'm moving to the Philippines because I've got a great job there and I'm going, you know, and that's it. My life has just radically changed. But if it's just like a thing where you're saying, I'm going to focus on university or something else, well, you're already retiring.
Everybody comes back to CS at a certain point. It doesn't matter how old you are. Just look at BSL. BSL still plays CSGO, albeit not as active as he did 1.6, obviously. But like, those players always come back, you know, for a couple of games, and you know, they remember how fun it is, and then they play a bit more, and all of a sudden, you know, they're playing gathers and pickup games and whatnot. It just happens. It's that kind of a game. You can't really leave Counter-Strike, it's evident by you know. Look at what you did that show event with the old NIP guys.
Yeah, now Set's playing again.
Yeah. So, yeah. It's pretty fun to see. And I think that's why also, like, the CS legends, or the legends of the CS community, are kind of extra special. Because there's always that hope that they might come back, right? Because they never really leave.
I actually can't even imagine the hype that would happen if Set announced his return to, like, a professional level. Or at least just, like, an attempt to do it.
Yeah, him and Spawn.
Well, the way I understood it is because Set, he played Source at the end, didn't he?
Yeah, he played for Complexity in CGS.
And a lot of people I've been talking to have said Set had like the raw materials to be like the best player ever, but then Source sort of died with all that nonsense that happened. So I don't know if that's true.
He was definitely the best 1.6 player at the time he swapped over to Complexity, and Complexity started playing CSS. I don't think Set was anywhere near the same player he was in Source as he was in 1.6, because he wasn't anywhere near the best Source player in the world.
All right, fair enough. So that's how it is.
So, yeah, but, you know, he's obviously an immensely talented player, and I think if he finds the time to put into it, he could definitely be one of the best players in the world. I think he's kind of the same caliber as Real, the former 1.6 player from Norway. And he's also one of those guys who occasionally pops up to play a couple of games, and after 5 hours of straight playing, all of a sudden he's
he's good
again.
He's just
doming heads left and right.
Yeah, talking about other players that, you know, have made sort of halfway comebacks, or at least have been dipping in a little bit, I guess Gobby from the from the the old team is also has also been dipping in. He's not really committed to it, but he's been there every once in a while, stepping in and out. Known as being,
seems
I
like
think,
for
one
every
of the
EPS finals.
Yeah, exactly. And as far as I know, known as being one of the all time greatest in-game leaders in 1.6. So.
Oh yeah, he was definitely among the best in-game leaders in 1.6. And those mouse teams, I'm not really sure how much of those mouse teams you were able to catch, but those mouse teams with Gabi and Tixo and Six, all those guys were just super fun to watch.
Yeah, and who else? I guess, and now because we're just waiting for people to join, so we might as well be name-calling a little bit more. Trace announced his retirement a while ago when he was in Fnatic with Freeze and the rest of him, in Global Offensive here, that is. And I think that a lot of people felt like that was a big loss. So it'd be fun if he decided, I'm going to give it a second go around. And there are some other Danish players too, I guess, like Sonic and Sunder and also Ave.
Yeah. So, and Minet.
Yeah.
Or Mine, or like how you want to pronounce that name. But yeah, like a lot of those ex-MTW players from Denmark. Or if you want to go really far back in time, how cool wouldn't it be to see the old Titans players start playing CSGO, like KK and Galahad, all those guys coming back? That would be so much fun. SPX.
Yeah. If you're out there watching and you know some of these guys, and you know, just give them a poke. Tell them to come back and
just
try.
Lock them in your basement and just make sure there's a PC internet connection and just enough water for them to survive a couple of weeks.
Exactly. See how they like it then. That'd be really cool. Okay, we've been talking for a while now, and I think this is Navi wanted a 5-minute break, and I guess that's fair enough. They had a pretty exhausting game on their hands, and
They've played three games already.
Exactly. This has been all Navi all evening, basically. And actually, while we're talking here, I do have the schedule for tomorrow, guys. So actually, there's a lot of Counter-Strike tomorrow. What we have is LDLC versus Penta, the German team we just saw, which used to be Berserk. That's the first game at 6 o'clock Central European time. Then we have Fnatic versus Nostalgia. But even better, we actually have the same time slot. We have Navi versus Epsilon. So we're going to be doing that game, without a doubt. Then we have Titan versus Epsilon and Fnatic versus Navi at 8 o'clock. So that's in the same time slot. Those two great games happening at the same time. Then we have Navi versus Overgaming. Could actually still be an interesting game. And then we have Uno Iron versus Nostalgia, VODS Pro versus ESC. So we have five games coming up for you guys tomorrow right here on the channel. And we're going to be covering them as well. More SLTV. We're basically going to be covering everything. And then that's Tuesday and leading into Wednesday when we're going to be doing our own Case King of the Hill tournament, which is going to be great fun as well. And actually, in that context, if you want to win in the Case King raffle that's going on, all you have to click is the link at the bottom of the page. There's a picture for the Facebook raffle. It's a Zoe keyboard you can win. We've already been giving away a bunch of stuff thanks to Case King and Alpenfreen and Zoe and all the rest of them, Beat Phoenix as well. So we really appreciate that kind of help. And you guys can participate in that raffle. If you like the page, you only have to do it once, but then you participate in all the raffles that are going on in the future as well. So it's definitely worth it. But I mean, now you asked me how I felt about Uno Iron on this map against Navi. How do you think? I mean, what do you think here? Is it? Would you feel more comfortable about an upset if it was Mousesports versus Navi on this map, or Uno Iron versus Navi on this map?
Mousesports.
Yeah, you think for Mousesports is a caliber above Uno Iron? That's my feeling too.
Yeah, but then again, that's has a lot to do with the fact that Mousesports has been a team for a lot longer, and a lot of these players in Uno Iron are not new to the scene by any means, but I think their activity level throughout the history of CSGO has been very up and down. Hunden, for example, throughout Source, he was very active, and it was always in one of the best teams in Denmark. And then he, you know, goes on a break, or I guess kind of retires, as every CS player does. Same thing with Kevin, like a lot of these players just kind of dip in and out of the scene from time to time. So I think also that might be able to hurt them. But you mentioned PNX and him going on a rampage versus ESC, and he's actually a very exciting talent to follow, because obviously by now everybody knows who IZ is. And PNX is a former teammate of IZ, and they are pretty similar players.
Okay.
Just crazy players with insane aim, who are gonna drop a ton of frags on the board, and we saw how fast IZ went from being a talent to being a legitimate top player. And I wouldn't be too surprised if that was the case with PNX either.
Okay, well, so that's really good information, because there's nothing more fun, I think, than watching the growth of someone new who's coming out and just turns out to be really, really good at the game. So we'll see. Maybe we should keep him on our radar. Obviously, we have the knife round coming up here. It's Unu Ein versus Navi. And this is the SLTV Star Series Season 10. Thank you for joining us this whole evening. This is the last match that we're going to be covering, but it's been a pretty long day already, and we had a great weekend with lots of Counter-Strike. So glad you guys want to tune in and support us here. A big thanks and a big shout out to the subscriber team that's growing all the time. We really appreciate you guys subbing to the channel. It helps us out a lot. We're keeping active content on here, and we're going to try and keep it up as much as we can. We're going to be doing it all week, and it's just going to continue to go on here. And follow the channel if you haven't already. I'm Anders, with me is Vendetta. Semler's on a bit of a break this evening, but we still love him. And shout out to you, Semler, if you are listening in from somewhere else. Of course, he's going to be back soon enough as well. He's definitely, a part owner and core of the channel here. But now we're ready for it. Edward with a little bit of a peek over on long. MSL in the middle. Spots a couple of people jumping by. And Navi actually, again, in the pistol round, a lot faster than they normally are in other rounds. But let's see if it's going to be enough. Hunden could have caught some guys there. Navi peeking in and then going back again. They're really moving around a lot here.
They really are. I guess trying to get a feel for what's going on around the map. But as for right now, nothing comes of it. And I like this from Unai and MSL and Tensky.
Yeah, this could be huge, right? Starix catches them, but they catch Starix a little bit more. Headshot from MSL. He's down to 10 HP, but they're going to go for it now. The question is, can Navi get out into the middle? Smoke's going to be up here. Hunden can't really find the shot just yet. And up in the B bomb site, is he going to... There's a crack. He can shoot right through here. Going a lot of damage, but not going to get the shot. And they lose the two people inside. Hunden charging through, and he's going to pick up the one kill. So it's down to a 2-1-3. Bomb goes down. That's the first victory for Navi. But holding this bomb site is going to be very tough. They don't even have a flashbang here. C is going to pick up one and make it a 2-on-2. But I think Zeus is about to die to one single shot. Actually being missed a lot here. And that's a problem for Kevin, because now Cease knows where he's coming from. And the Russian talent here has already picked up a triple kill. Going to go for the last one. Going to pick up the last one. Quad kills. Seized again. Coming out massively in a pistol round.
Yeah, that probably should have been Unu Ein's round. I think Hunden definitely had the possibility to pick up at least one frag before Navi was able to clear out that B bomb site. And also, if Kevin is able to pick up Suze earlier, seeing how Suze was only at 2 HP, I think they would have been able to pick Seast off in a bit more awkward situation. And the way it turned out, Seast was just in a really solid position to actually punish Kevin.
Yeah. I agree. It would have still... Kevin could have still gone down even if he had... even if he got the first shot there. But I agree. The time it took meant that Seast had a very good understanding of what was happening. And that's obviously a problem. Tensky trying for the one deke here. A very Danish idea. And MSL has perfected it. There's the one. Goes for a second one. Oh my god. That could have been a double kill. MSL now running out of bullets. And Tensky's going to pick up another one here. Now we need to kill these players. And they are gonna. But tell me about the Danish one deke here, Vendetta. Why is that so popular?
The Danish Deke, that's something that brings up nightmares from my days in Source. It's, I don't know why, but Danes love Deagles. Not surprisingly, seeing how effective they are with them, but... yeah, it's just a thing of its own. If you ever seen Wants play, the former recent Imperial Dignitas... Well, I think it was Indignitas in Source. Might be...
I think you're right.
Well, yeah. Either way, Wants was the one who was playing with Fetish and all those guys in Source, and he was by far the best Danish players. Actually, he was probably one of the best top three players in the world, together with Shoxi and RPK. And he was just notorious for just executing entire teams with the Deagle.
Oh, bit of an execution coming out from Edward over here. Takes down PNX and Hunden and goes for a triple, because why not? He's already on fire. MSL's going to go down. Tensky inside here. So the first three rounds are going to be going down pretty quickly here. I mean, it hasn't been painless for Navi. Actually, they've lost a lot of rifles here. But Unu Ein, now they're going to be able to pick up a rifle. And I'm looking at you, Kevin, for the AWP. But he's actually 50 short from being able to buy the armor. So it's going to be without head armor. Not really the biggest deal, but it's a little bit of a shame that he's 50 short from that.
Well, they're up against AKs. I mean, barring Edward and Stark, so I don't think he's too worried about that.
Oh, probably not. Probably not. And he's going to have an HE grenade instead. So actually, maybe even if he had the $50, he might have gone for this anyway, I suppose.
Yeah, I think that's the more sensical move, actually, because you kind of have to assume that they're going to be fully kitted out with AKs, and that kind of...
MSL, if he wants to peek, alright, he's going to peek completely naked. That's really dangerous. Now he's going to flash back, but a great opening pick here as Edward goes down. But I was going to say, he can actually bank a flashbang off of the corner then, and then sort of it bounces into the middle, and it's a really, really good pop flash, but he just goes for the straight peek.
Yeah, I think he actually got a flash in from Hunden that time when he was in CT spawn. So I think that's why he opted to go for it. And right now, we're seeing Navi do a lot of the same things they did in the first match we saw today, with a lot of B splits, and again, not really working out too well right now.
No, it's definitely not, and maybe they haven't learned a thing from the timeout they just took here. Starix picks off one, Tenski goes for the battle, Seuss is going to get grenaded all the way to hell, and Guardian in the middle picking up a good kill here, but it's too late. The bomb is down inside the B bomb site. And for Starix and Guardian to try and retake this with 25 seconds left, really, I don't think it's going to happen at all. If they can get some good kills in here, it'll still be all right for them. But if they survive with three members alive, I think Uni Iron are going to be really happy.
Oh, definitely. I think Kevin is living a tiny bit dangerously because Starix has just dropped down into CT spawn.
Yeah, but now he's walking, so Kevin knows. And 6 seconds left, 5 seconds. Starix is going to commit to it. He goes down before the timer, and that's good news. But a really good hold coming out from Uni Iron, and actually just, I don't know, again, you kind of called it out already. They go for the same B-split push that did not work at all against against Berserk.
Penta.
Yeah, Penta.
Yeah. Yeah, and it's the same thing. They kind of commit with a couple of, not two people, and then there's another group of two people in mid kind of hanging back, and they're leaving the bomb basically on a solo mission trying to enter the B bomb site from tunnels. And that it just seems like a weird thing to do. Even initially, even if things go according to plan, that's a pretty risky move, because sure, you might get control over mid, but you know, if the guy with the bomb drops in tunnels, the potential for any CT to run in into upper and just hold the bomb from there is really big. So I'm a bit surprised that Navi continued to do it. But then again, they did one. I mean, they did win versus Penta on Dust 2 by doing this, because they made it. You know, they made other things work eventually. So maybe this is something that they just want to try and kind of refine while they have the opportunity before G3.
Maybe it is. Tenski misses or gets to survive a little bit longer, but MSL's gonna get taken down, and Tenski drops as well. That was a bit of a clumsy defense coming out from Uno Ai. What happened with that? Because MSL just got shot in the back.
Yeah, that's definitely a slip in communication from the Danish team. MSL was probably convinced that Tenski was actively peeking towards Upper Dark, which he obviously wasn't, and that led to two easy entry frags for Navi. And I think even if Tenski kind of had peeked, I think Navi would have had the opportunity. They were too far in to not really be able to grab that bomb site.
Yeah. And that shows you, I think, is a good illustration of how much it matters when you're really communicating with your team. I mean, I guess all... I mean, this is something that happens in matchmaking too, but just the call of saying, this is what I'm doing.
Either he doesn't even have to peek, as long as he tells MSL that, okay, I'm not peeking now because I'm A, flashed, or I'm reloading, or I just don't want to peek right now. As long as you give that information so MSL can adjust to it, that's all you need. And that would have probably saved the Danish guys from giving up that B bomb site and the round.
It's going to be a Navi rush. That's really rare, and maybe there's a reason why. Tenski's going to take down one, rushing around the corner. Edward is going to go down as well, and Navi just killing themselves here in the B bomb site. Not exactly the ideal round. MSL with the one kill, he's going to go down, but I don't think it matters any longer. Starix has no time to reload. He's going to re-peek once again here in Hunden. Should just be playing it safe. There's no reason to give Starix the opportunity to make this 1-on-2. Just wait for him to either walk away or put the bomb down. And if he tries, you can just kill him easily. And I'm glad to see Hunden just playing it safely here.
Yeah, I think that's actually one thing Danish teams has in common. They're pretty composed when it comes to their playstyle.
Starix, they peek him once more. I think, did he see him a little bit then? I'm not sure. Starix going to walk in here and Hunden going to take him down. So there it is. It's 2-4. And Navi can buy here, but that was... I mean, how often, how many times can you count in the past, I don't know, 10 Navi games we've seen that they've actually rushed anything?
I could probably count it on one hand.
Yeah, it's not that often, right?
It's a rarity. That's for sure. It's like a legendary card in Hearthstone, I guess.
Yeah, it doesn't have to happen all that often. And I guess that could be the reason why they did it this time. They just thought, all right, they're not going to expect it because we never do it. And then it doesn't work out at all. So maybe that's just going to redouble their idea that we don't want to rush anywhere. It's like cementing the fact that that's not a good idea.
They probably felt that like they had a good grip on how to take that B-bomb site from Upper Dark. because they got him pretty easily, seeing how there was this slip of communication between Tenski and MSL in the previous round. So maybe they kind of figured that, well, oh, they don't really seem to be paying attention at the B-bomb site at all, so we could just truck in.
Yeah, maybe. If they go for A this time, I mean, look at the incredible setup here from the Danish team. They have Kevin down on short. He's going to get smoked off a little bit, but he just readjusts for a second. And we'll see if we can get to see Guardian, who doesn't have an ult, but Kevin at least who does. A little bit of source nostalgia coming out here. Kevin actually gets a good shot in, but he goes down immediately. MSL in the CT spawn is going to be dead, but Hunden peeks out, gets the one kill, and should be reloading right here. He's still got help down on short from PNX, who misses a shot here. Hunden goes down. This is starting to look a little bit ugly for Uno Ein, because if they lose, they can't keep winning or losing rounds. Trading back and forth like this is not going to be good for them. Starix coming up from behind is going to get the kill, and now it's on PNX. The hero of the game against ESC is going to get dropped by Navi. Guardian with the double kill in this round, and I don't know. I mean, that. Okay, explain that, this to me, Ventero. They had four people at that bomb site.
Three. MSL was... I don't really think we can count MSL because he was holding off the middle, and as soon as Navi went or attempted or wanted to sell the fake towards B when they smoked off for CT spawn, MSL ran towards middle to clear it out, and that kind of gave out his position. He couldn't really help the A side at all after that.
Fair enough. We'll call it three then.
Yeah, but I still think that should have been a round for Uno Iron In. I'm surprised Hunden wasn't able to pick up at least two frags in that situation, because when he came out of Red Eye, the Red Eye corner on the A-bomb site, he ran into three super flash Navi players. They were completely blind. One of them even had his back turned to him.
Yeah.
And that should have been at least two easy kills and a potential third. Instead, he ends up just picking off one, and after that, everything just unraveled for Uno Iron.
That's a real shame, because that could have been a huge round for them. They have 2-6 right now, so things aren't really sort of spiraling out of control. I mean, they're on the board. Navi did win the pistol round, and then it's been, you know, they've had two rifles round that they can win, and that's a good statement all on its own, that they're able to win rifle rounds against Navi on the CT side here. How many rounds do you think they need in total to make this a good first half for the Danes?
Oof. At least 7 rounds, I want to say.
All
simply
right.
Because I'm not really sure how good their T side is. Obviously, they could be amazing if Kevin is on his game with the AWP and PNX is able to run around and pick off people. But I think 7 would be at least something they would need to beat a team like Navi.
I mean, we saw how good Navi were on the CT side earlier. That's where they really brought it back, because they lost horribly on the first half against Penta. So I guess that is a problem. Good grenade comes out here from PNX. See if he can do a little bit more. He's got a FAMAS, and he's up against potentially three people, so this is actually going to be really tough. The smokes are definitely working out, and Kevin is holding the A-bomb site, but if PNX goes down, Kevin is all alone in the world and in a lot of trouble here. He's running back. They heard him already, so PNX is now almost certainly dead. This is going to be hard, really hard. Kevin with a good kill coming in, and backup is coming for PNX, but the flashes are too powerful. Hunden going down as well, leaving Kevin alone. One against a lot of people. Backup is coming quick from Tenski. He's fighting out. If he can kill C's, that's huge. He will. The bomb is dropped, and this might be all they need. Sick flank coming in from Tenski here. Edward with the rifle, trying to see if he can take down Kevin. 24 HP, and Kevin does go down, but so does Edward. That flank from Tenski, that was really, really good timing.
Yeah, absolutely. And yeah, that definitely saved the round for Uno IN. Especially because it kind of relieves a lot of pressure from Kevin. He doesn't have to worry about getting pushed out from two different places. He can only focus on one spot for a long time. And yeah, it worked out for the Danish side.
Yes, it did. They still don't have a lot of money, unfortunately. That's really sad, because Kevin lost his AWP and they couldn't actually pick it up again. Or they didn't, at least. So they're down to AK, AM4s, and a single FAMAS here. See if they can keep winning. If they can win one more round, they're going to force Navi to eco, and that's where things get a little bit interesting, I think, for the Danes. So there's a lot riding on this. On the other hand, if they lose, then they're going to be ecoing, so it's all on this.
Yeah, and ooh, this is going to be a tough hold if Navi actually decides to go towards shore. Kevin has to do a lot of work if they commit to this catwalk push.
I don't think they will. Oh, will they? Yeah, they're going to fake a mid push as well. Starix is going to go on, and now up on catwalk here. Kevin is going to get triple teamed, and he goes down. Hunden, FAMAS down here. Not going to be easy to pick anyone off. I think they're going to have to play for the straight retake, though. A great grenade is going to take down Sue. So now the retake's a little bit more likely, but Guardian is up here, and if he's on point, I mean, we know what happens then.
Yeah, PNX is more or less shut out from this as long as Guardian is aiming towards Long, so something needs to happen from Unui and from a different spot than Long.
Guardian picks up that kill effortlessly, walks into the middle, is going to have a lot of targets here. There's the first, MSL is next, Guardian misses the shot, and that's going to be the retake. They don't have a kit, but they have just enough time, I think.
Yeah, this should be be enough time for the fuse.
So really well played, good retake.
Yeah, it really was. I think PNX probably should have waited a tiny bit more. Obviously, it could have been the Danish team opting to make him kind of the distraction, because it did take the focus from Guardian away from Catwalk and Spawn, so it worked out in the end, but I guess in an optimal world, you'd probably see PNX waiting a tiny bit more before he pushes up Long. But yeah.
And Navi really don't care. They actually bought up. I thought they were going to ego. I mean, obviously, getting the bomb down meant they had the $800 bonus, but this is 2 AKs and 3 Galils and only 1 smoke grenade and a couple of flashes. This is really, really not an easy round, I think, for Navi to win. Grenade in the middle does a terrible amount of damage as well. Hunden gets a little bit returned onto him, but that's a fine grenade.
Yeah, and I think the reasoning behind Navi's buy is simply that they know how on the ropes the Danish team is. So if they win this round, it's back to eco for Unui N, and they're willing to take that risk, seeing how they have 6 rounds already, and they probably feel quite confident in the fact that they will be able to take more rounds as the half goes long.
Yeah, maybe they will. We're in the 11th round, so there's, I mean, 4 rounds after this. It's going to be really close here. If Unui N win this, it's going to be a sure eco, and that's actually going to tie the score, I think. If they win this round, Unui N, they're going to tie it. PNX takes a lot of damage here down in pits, going to need a little bit of backup, but it's pretty far away at the moment. You can see Hunden charging in. Kevin picks up a kill, and there's Hunden with the 1. Great double. Can he get the 3rd as well? Guardian goes down. Great play. Hunden with fantastic triple kills. C is going to jump down into CT spawn. A heroic play, but it's not going to win him the round here. It's a 1-on-3 with 25 seconds left. If he can kill Kevin, that'd be huge, but he can't. MSL coming up from behind, but the man of the match here definitely is the Hound. Or Hunden, if you prefer in Danish. 5-6, moving into the 12th round. That was great.
Yeah, and it looked a tiny bit shaky at the start there, because it took, it felt like a little bit too much time to actually down the first guy who PNX had already softened up for him. Luckily, though, he connected with headshots on the 2 next ones. But I was getting scared for Hunden right there.
Now, C is going to throw a flash over, and it's a pretty effective flash, but they still only have pistols coming out here, and not sure it's going to be too much of a problem. Actually, Kevin goes down in the pit. PNX, oh, you got to be joking me. He gets swarmed by angry Navi members, and now they picked up an AK and an AWP, and obviously that AWP is the big difference, because Guardians is still alive. They can't lose this round. Come on, Vendetta.
No, this is actually horrible for Unui N, and I think a lot of that actually falls on PNX, because he basically left Kevin alone to die. That was brutal to watch, and that should have been an easy way to pick up at least 3 frags for PNX if he actually played with his teammate.
Yeah, I think unfortunately you're right, so that's a real shame. Guardian is going to take down MSL as he gets a little bit too curious. He's no cat, but it's still got him killed, and it's a 1-on-5 here. Hunden going to be walking out. Last time he got a triple, this time he's going to have to almost double it with a pentakill. In fact, 5 is what he's looking for. There's the first one down, so 4 more to go. 30 seconds here, Navi are going to put down the bomb, and there's absolutely nothing you can do to stop it, so this is a pretty big upset, I think. They're not even going to have that much money in the upcoming round. They're really in a deep hole now, I think.
Yeah, that was just a straight up awful round from the Danish team. There's no other way to put it. You're not. Navi almost had a clean sweep on an eco.
Yeah.
That's not supposed to happen. And I think all of that came down to the fact that PNX did not help out Kevin at all. So your opera is down for basically no value at all. PNX is going to get overwhelmed as soon as Kevin dies as well, because all the attention is focused towards him right after.
Yeah.
And he's not going to down 5 people with a silenced Colt. There's just not enough bullets. And
no.
And after that, they start re-peeking towards a Guardian with an AWP, which is never a good idea.
Well, I think that's actually, like, because this was a bit of an improvised round from Navi, but the idea of pushing out Long, if you do it early in a round and then you fall back but leave one guy with an AWP in the pit, I think it's a really cool position, because so many CT teams will actually go and see what's going on, because they've lost Long already, and if nothing has happened for a good 30 seconds there, they're going to have an inkling of, they just want to go and see what's going on, and when they do, there's an AWP waiting for them, so doing that kind of play is a little bit tricky, I think. Now, right now, they've been trading equally, and PNX with a good damage here. Not having enough bullets to take down Starix, and Starix will go down to Hunden. Guardian actually going to go down as well. It's a 2-on-3. Edward and Seuss left, and Seuss can pick up a kill, but he's a little bit too scared right now.
Ooh, and Edward smartly decides to drop down instead of taking that challenge as Hunden, but this is still around Unuayan should win.
It absolutely is. So maybe the Danes are going to bounce right back here. MSL orped up in the middle, just on scopes, and now Edward gets the first kill. He's got 27 seconds to try and do this. They're both up on short, so he can find both of them, and the bomb is here as well. He's going to peek up once. Tenski's there. Edward spraying is going to get the kill. 18 seconds. CSET 75, his hand's going to pick up the bomb and run for Hunden's position. He's right on that edge. Edward jumps down, spots him, and gets the kill. You must be joking. Triple kill from Edward. Oh my god, that should have been the Danes round, I think.
Yeah, and that was just, again, disastrous play from the Danish side. Tenski, obviously, I get the intention of dropping off the Colt because your teammate has full HP, but he dropped off the Colt in a position where MSL had to, no, not MSL, but, well, the remaining teammate had to run out and get it because he dropped it past them. And that left him in an awkward situation where he's completely open to Edward. And after he's done that, he runs away instead of being there for the potential trade. So instead of Edward trying to make it into a 1v1v1v1, right?
Yeah.
Unuayan did that job for him, which is just ridiculous.
It's really, really a shame because the Danish team's actually succeeded in getting themselves into some really good positions in this game, but it feels like a few too many times they've also managed to put themselves out of that good position again, and that's just not good enough. Great flashbang in the middle is going to take down Hunden, and now they're in the CT spawn. In fact, Seuss running the other way. It's going to be a push for the A-bomb site, and they did not see that coming. They thought that was going to be a B-push, I think.
Oh, yeah, they did.
The people in A did.
That was a pretty fun variation of an A split actually coming out from Seuss. So even though he died, he definitely did enough work to distract Unuayan.
Yeah, really nicely done. Tenski fighting it out with Seuss. It's going to come out on top, but he's also alone. And the backstab is in here. Edward going instantly for the long play. And that is pretty going to make it almost impossible for Tenski. There's no way he can guess where Edward is. And Edward can hear him trying to run away. So the game is up. Edward's going to jump down. Tenski sees it coming. And not going to be a round win. It's going to be 9-5 here. All right.
So, yeah. Well, it's actually a big shame for Unuayan because, as you said, they've gotten themselves into a lot of good positions a lot of the times. And they have 5 rounds, and this could have easily been 9-5 in the Danish team's favor. Because, obviously, if they pick up those 2 rounds that they really should have had, then we're talking a completely different situation, economically speaking, for Na'Vi.
Yeah, I agree. It's just been a strange game in many ways. Na'Vi has had a couple of really sick rounds, but I think Unuayan, more than anything, is they've been giving up a couple of rounds that maybe they shouldn't have, and that does change the dynamic of this first half a lot. It, at least economically speaking, as you're saying, they could have had a lot more money to work with. They've been ecoing for a few too many rounds, and even though one of those eco rounds was great, and that is, again, another successful grenade from Hunden. If only they could throw one more here, Na'Vi could lose a couple of members already. Oh, Starix hesitating a lot here. MSL is going to be able to return on him, so that's pretty good. But in the middle, Hunden goes down, and this last round of the half is not looking good here. PNX is going to be jumping through the smoke. Mag 7 in hand. No, he's actually trying to jump up, and inside the B bomb site, MSL is hiding in some more smoke. Great headshot comes in. Seuss is going to go down as well, so this is not over yet. The Danes, they do not surrender easily. MSL, can he pick up a quad kill here? If he takes down Guardian, but he's got to do it quick, otherwise Edward is going to wrap around him. Guardian is going to walk right in and take down MSL. You've got to be joking. Alright, bomb is even going to go down. PNX jumps in. There's the one. He has to hit one pellet here on Edward, and Edward is dead. That's all it is. Trying a little bit, missing the shot. Oh my god, PNX, 4 HP, and a straight headshot. There it is. Double kill for him, and it finishes 9-6. God, that was close.
Way too close. And I think PNX had some of the more awkward smoke coordination I've seen in a while, because he spent a good 15 seconds inside of that smoke in CT spawn trying to figure his way out of it. That was just weird, really weird to watch. But yeah, works out. At least Uno-IN, I mean, it seems like we're kind of just constantly badgering Uno-IN like they're doing a horrible job. But they got 6 rounds on the CT side versus Na'Vi.
Yeah, they did. 9-6. I'm still impressed by Uno-IN. It's a shame because I think, as you said, the score could have been reversed. They could have been a 9 and Na'Vi could have been in 6 rounds if things had turned out just a little bit differently. But it's the name of the game here. If you're just joining us, then welcome to the stream. This is Room on Fire. I'm Anders, with me is Vendetran. Normally we'd have Semler with us as well, but he's just on a little bit of a break this evening. We have the second half coming up between Uno-IN and Na'Vi. This is the SLTV Star Series Season 10. So thank you for joining us again. Hope you enjoy your stay. And hope you're going to tune back in tomorrow. We start 1 hour earlier tomorrow than we did today, but it's going to be great fun. A lot of really cool games coming up. Follow and subscribe if you want to give us a helping hand, and we'll keep trying to bring you some cool Counter-Strike content. But that's about it. Now we're getting ready for it. And pistol round here, Ven. What happens to Uno-IN, you think, if they lose this pistol?
I think that's the time to wave the white flag if you're the Danish team. But you know, you don't want to give up hope, obviously. So
that was. I'm sorry. That was truly a sexy shot coming out from Seuss there. No, that was Starik. Sorry, he's gonna go down now. Ed was charging through the smoke. Gonna pick up the bomb carrier, and it's a 4-on-3. This isn't over yet, but things are not looking too good. With that shot, though, it changes a lot. Seuss is very nearly dead, and they're being wrapped around as well. So very nice job here from Uno-IN, just adjusting to the pressure put on. Guardian up here in the bomb site, taking a fight with 2 people, and very likely not gonna come out on top. Seuss has done some work at the other end of the map, but this is a weird 2-on-2.
It's a really weird one. And this favors the Danish team.
Yeah, it does. And Kevin and Tensky will clean it up. Seuss, I had no idea how he survived that long. The whole time he just had 2 HP then. And they are going to pick up the pistol round. So nicely done from Uno-IN. I actually think, I mean, it doesn't seal the round, but when Starix got that kill over on Long, and they just fall back without taking any damage, I really thought that was maybe going to be the end of it.
Yeah, because he definitely spotted out at least 2 or 3 more members from the Danish side. So Na'Vi has all the time in the world to make the rotation and basically just wait for the oncoming siege from Uno-IN. But they didn't really take advantage of it.
Na'Vi didn't buy any body armor this round, but they did buy a bunch of pistols, and they charged lower and upper dark, and then just got completely wrecked by Uno-IN. Taking a little bit of damage was Kevin, but that was a really, really good round from the Danish team. I like the fact that they haven't given up any rifles here. Just, you know, really cool round coming out from them. That's good.
Yeah, really nice anti-eco coming out from the Danish guys. And I actually wouldn't be too surprised if we... Well, even though Kevin bought up with an AK this round, if they win this one, I wouldn't be surprised to see him drop the AK and go for an AWP next round. And I'm really excited to see how they play around that.
Yeah, if they're going to make it the main focus, trying to get him to get some pickoffs, or if it's just going to be another tool in their arsenal. I guess teams do play differently when they have that, you know, star offer like that. MSL and Tensky, a great opening. I mean, they just... Obviously, it's pistols here for Na'Vi, but they're not showing much fear. They really just stroll into the bombsite and get the kills.
Yeah, I think the reason why they're able to do that as well is because they're going together. They're going as a group, so they have that failsafe, really. If one falls off to a quick pickoff, then someone's there to retaliate.
Okay, Starix is literally thrown out of the bombsite with a headshot from Tensky. That was really cool. The ragdoll just catapults out of there. Now, Hunden gonna pick up the one, and a quick double, and they only lose PNX to a really sick shot from Starix, but it's not enough to do anything more than that. The score is tied at 9-9, and Guardian has picked up an AWP, and we're looking for you, Kevin. He's picked up one as well.
Yeah, so what we expected kind of happened. Kevin gives PNX his AK, and so it begins the AWP battle.
Now, last time we saw Na'Vi on this map, they were even further behind than this, and they still brought it back. That was against the Penta team, the German team. And here, well, Seized with a very, very fortunate angle, takes down PNX. And then takes down MSL. They're trying for a really quick B split here, and it's really just not working out at all. Tensky in the middle is going to be able to pick off Seuss, but Na'Vi should not be able to lose this round any longer.
No, and the only reason Uno-IN can come back into this is if Na'Vi gives away easy pickoffs. So I guess if Seuss is opting to constantly peek from the plateau area, that's a potential area where the Danish team could come back into it, but if they just play this safe and don't really give any opportunity to give away kills, they should be fine.
Yeah, and I think even the Danes have realized that, you know, you can see them crouching around, they're hoping, praying that they are going to be able to find some member of Na'Vi in an awkward position. I mean, if they make it 2-on-3, I think they're definitely going to go for it. But if they don't find anyone, and we can see from the minimap here that they won't find anyone, then I'm almost sure then they're going to try and just leave it at that. 30 seconds it's insanity running out here, I feel like. If they kill Starix and Guardian both, that's going to be really impressive. Kevin trying to come around the corner here, misses the shot, and does get that one, and then Guardian comes in with the kill. So I am not sure that was really worth it. I mean, they have money to buy here anyway, but I feel with that little time left, that's a real fantasy, trying to do that.
Yeah, that was a bit of a optimistic play, to say the least. But, okay, they still managed to kit out people with a decent weaponry, so I guess it's not all bad, only Hun having to go with the Galil, but yeah, I think they definitely could have saved a couple of rifles and some money there.
Yeah, going into the 20th round, it's now a one-round lead for Na'Vi, and there was also no bomb plant happening that round, which means the Danes kind of need to, at the very least, put the bomb down this round and preferably just outright win it, because otherwise they're going to start ecoing, and that's really where the game went south, I think, for Penta, is when they started to eco. Tenski does actually significant damage to himself with that grenade, so a little bit of a shame that he ran into that, but I guess he was hoping to catch some member of Na'Vi falling back from that.
Yeah, that was the intention, but it ended up being a bit of a similar nade.
A bit of a similar nade. Well, in the middle, Edward's ready with the pop flash here. Seuss is already going to catch one. Edward, there's the flash. Where's the peak? It's going to be right there. Edward actually counter flashed as well, and Seuss can't find anyone. There's Edward with just the one kill, which means up in the bomb site, Seuss is alone here. He's going to walk out, and PNX will take him down. This is a 2-on-3 that the Na'Vi can definitely win. Look how low they are.
Yeah, and actually, the biggest worry for Uno INN is that both of the players with low HP are the riflers.
Well, Kevin doesn't even care. He says, I can use a rifle at point-blank range just fine. If Starix walks in here, is it going to be the same deal? Kevin right down, and Guardian trying to throw some grenades into the bomb site. Bomb is ticking away inside, and Starix charging in, looking for the kill. Going to go down to MSL, and Guardian picks up an AWP and runs away. I'm not sure if the Danes should have actually won this round, but they did.
They did. I guess that's karma from the first half. They kind of deserve that one, I guess. With
it's
all the,
true. There's a balance in the universe, that's what you're saying.
Yeah, exactly. So you know, you do a misplay here, and Na'Vi makes a misplay here, and exactly. We'll call it even.
So the grenade that Edward threw right here, it's a really standard pop flash, you know, bounces, and we saw how it bounced out right in front of them. What I was worried about, I'm not sure if Edward flashed himself or if someone else counter-flashed Edward, but either way, that had a really big impact. If Edward hadn't been flashed there, the whole of Uno Iron would have just died in the middle instantly, pretty much.
Yeah. I think it was a counter-flash. It was not Edward who flashed himself. I'm pretty certain of that.
Okay, well, that's good news. Now, Danish team out on long, going to take down Starix, who spent a lot of time walking around ramp, even though they knew that the pressure was on, so I'm not sure how Starix got caught then. In the corner, Edward is going to be able to pick up one kill, but he needs a lot of backup now. He's going to go down, and no one to the return kill here. Now they're charging in through the smoke as well. It's Guardian looking for the crossover here, but they have a lot of time on the Danish side here to do something else. They don't have to keep going for the site.
Ooh, PNX getting put down to 16 HP. Seuss, though, is really low HP.
Yeah, grenade comes in. Guardian walks out. It's going to get taken down. A lot of weird mistakes this round from Na'Vi, I would say. I actually think they had a huge chance of winning this. But I don't know what happened there. That was weird.
Yeah, I think Edward probably should have been able to get at least one kill. And in addition to that, someone from Na'Vi should have been able to really help him out in that situation. So when all of the focus from Uno INN is on Edward in that corner by the cars, that's the optimal time for Na'Vi to push out and try to wreak havoc.
Yeah, that was the main thing that really worried me, just what you said right there. Edward, this is not a good corner to be caught in, but when they didn't check it, he should have got the first kill, and then when they're all focused, as you're saying, on this corner, the rest should push out. Instead, what they did is they waited until Edward was actually dead, and then they said, okay, let's run out and try and avenge him. But then, obviously, they're no longer focused on that corner. They're focused on you instead. And then also, Starix getting picked off in the beginning, just, you know, jumping around the actual slope here was just very confusing. So Navi can't afford mistakes like that. I mean, Unu Ein, they're 12-2. They have a two-round lead. They don't have an impressive amount of money, but they have enough to make this happen. I mean, 8 and 10,000 on Kevin and PNX here.
Yeah, and I just want to point out, as so we don't forget it, but look at MSL, the kind of game he's having right now. 27-6 and 14.
Navi pushing up, and they get completely destroyed. Seized, also going to fall here. Navi really, really just throwing it away at this point. This is... I guess it's an alright attempt, but they're not coming up with anything at the moment.
I think that's a bit of a desperation move because, well, they've only gotten one round so far on their CT side. So they're obviously trying something new, pushing two guys into lower, but Uno IN just playing solidly and working as a group and works out for them. That was a really effortless round from the Danish team, and now they're up 13-10 and Navi has to eco. So this should be 14-10.
It definitely should be. It's the one round where the Danes really can't screw it up and walk into any kind of trouble. That would be heartbreaking. But the way it's looking, they're rushing the bomb site and they've chosen the right round to do it with. Seized in the back with the Deagle. Does get the one kill in, but that's all it takes. Coming up from behind really quick is Seuss, but he's going to go down. Edward to follow with a good headshot, but this is not enough here. Unu Ein should still be able to. There's no bullets left for Edward. That could have been a 2-on-3, actually. If there was bullets in that gun, this could have been a round for Navi, I think. That's a big difference. And now, well, Staris and Guardian charging in here, but they are going to go down eventually. So the Danes, they equalize. But that is... That's the most disappointing M4 we've ever seen.
Well, that's what Semler always says. Whenever you pick up an M4 after a gunfight, just assume that it's going to be empty. Every time.
That was
so unfortunate for Edward. And you could just imagine the panic he is feeling the second he pulls up that Colt and starts spraying wildly towards the guy at Plateau.
Guardian wins the duel out on long. This is 10-14, but it's definitely not over yet. And Navi can still come back into this. Guardian will pick up the first kill here, and there is an auto sniper as well on C. So Navi are trying to make adjustments here, but the weird thing is, I feel like so many of these rounds here on the second half could have easily been Navi's if they just didn't screw it up. Edward with a good return here. Guardian, now they have a man advantage again, and they don't need to keep peeking, but they will look at up on short here. If Seuss gets picked off, all of a sudden it's back to a 3-on-3. And they don't have to do it.
Oh, and Starix, if he continues on to push, he's going to get caught out by Hunden.
Yeah, he's waiting right here. Hunden around the corner, going to take him down. And again, why?
Yeah, a completely unnecessary move by Starix. I guess, obviously he wants information, but at that point, I don't really think it's necessary.
Great job by Seized in the middle, at least. But, a lot of really risky play coming out from the Danes. Seuss is going to be able to take... I'm not from the Danes, from the CT side here, from Navi. I'm not so sure about that. And I'm not sure if it's the pressure or if it's just... if it's something else. Navi don't seem to have their minds in the right place at the moment.
It's just like a bit of a recklessness, but I guess we've seen it from both teams in this game. Unu Ein has done similar mistakes in this game so far, so... In a way, it kind of balances out, but it's not the way you want to see teams play out these rounds.
No, and a little bit of a shame here. I actually think Starix could have gone down, but now in turn, it's a complete slaughter over at long. And Edward fighting in the middle here, going to go down to PNX. Kevin going to walk right into Starix. He misses a shot, and that's going to be the end. Now PNX getting shot in the back from the auto sniper is going to go down. And there's so much money on Unu Ein. That's the thing. It's going to be basically 14-14, I think, before... Unu Ein start to eco, so that's why, you know, they have a lot of rounds to throw away, but they don't actually just want to throw them away, right?
Oh no, absolutely not. They have to cherish every moment they have to actually get that match point in.
Oh, Guardian repeaks against Kevin. He actually saw him the first time, so maybe a little bit too brave coming out from Guardian, but that's a great start for Unu Ein. One more round there and match at map point, and that'd be a big relief for them. Seized is walking up here, auto sniper. Into Upper Dark, and PNX is right on the edge. Seized is going to be watching him already, and PNX takes one body shot and falls back. And that's a grenade. Oh,
what a nade.
Yeah, the money nade, right? The magic Avalus, Guardian calls it.
Yeah.
for some reason, I don't... He's from Slovakia, I don't know.
Yeah, that was a grenade. Because PNX made the right decision there. He's like, oh... There's an auto sniper there. I'm not going to take that fight. So he smartly backs off. Unfortunately, Seized has, that Warcraft 3 mode grenade.
Oh, Edward nearly got caught then. Smoke's going to come out as well. Kevin keeps pushing and takes him down through the smoke. So a little bit of mistiming there from Edward. Starix is going to peek up right against Tunden. Misses the shot, and that might be his death here. Goes for the shot and will take it. Now Tensky and Kevin can still win this. Great grenade comes in. There's the one. Kevin right at the edge here. Seized as the auto-sniper is coming up from long. The Danes have got to move, and they're too slow. There's the one right through the smoke. Kevin, can he get this shot? He can't. Seized. Saving the day. Another triple. He's at 23 kills, only outdone by Edward on 25, and then MSL, as you said, who's had a stunning game so far with 30 kills. But now, Unwine, this is the last buy that they can afford. If they lose this round, they are going to be in a world of trouble.
Yeah, so much pressure on the Danish team right now. And they're not really finding a way to deal with Seized and his auto-sniper.
No, I don't know. If they could have got up and got the bomb down, I think Seized coming down from long would have still been important, but it would have, at least the bomb plant would have helped them out so much here. Now they don't have the AWP on Kevin either, and that has actually been a factor in the last couple of rounds as well, just how good Kevin has been playing with the AWP. So it's not easy right now. Guardian in the middle takes a shot, and Hunden is down to 4 HP. They return a grenade, which actually does a lot of damage to Seuss. That was a great grenade.
Yeah, Unwine has actually been on point with a lot of their nades. I think I've seen Kevin with about like 6 nade kills or something up to this point.
Seuss trying to walk back here, wants to be a little bit safer. Gonna flash his way in. It's 45 seconds left. If they go up short here, then Guardian is there with the AWP. And I'd be surprised if he doesn't pick up at least a couple of kills from this. Flashes in here. Guardian is going to take down the one. Now Hunden left 4 HP. He's going to go down. There's the one. There's the two. Misses the third one. Can we get a fourth kill from Guardian? Yes. And how long before this auction of death closes? We don't know just yet. Kevin in the corner. Not really able to do anything so far. It's three. That's going to end at three. So it's all done. 15 rounds, very likely for Na'Vi now. They just can't buy on Uno Ain's side, and if they do anyway, I mean, I guess they could to try and force the... Yeah, they will. Do you agree here? I mean, otherwise no. They're playing for a tie.
At this point, play for a tie. Because what are your likely odds to win a round versus Guardian with an AWP, Seized on an auto-sniper, and a fully equipped Na'Vi team on... And they're going to be in an advantageous position pretty much regardless. With Unwine buying up like this. So I'm not really sure why they opted to go for a buy like this. I mean, I guess they want the win, but yeah. This is probably going to cost them the game.
It could, very likely. Two AKs, one Galil, and it has to come up big here. Seuss goes down. That's a sick opening from MSL, but the spray down. Edward does tremendous damage, and now the auto-sniper almost happens here. Now it's going to be a 2-on-3 retaken. Was that team damage coming in on Guardian then?
I have no idea.
Can they really do this? If the Danish team brings it back here to 16-14, that is going to be unbelievable. It's a 2-on-3 here. Starix and Guardian has to try and retake this. The bomb is already down. Tensky and MSL are very low on health here. And actually, Starix is right on the edge. Grenade in once. Guardian coming up from upper. And he's up against Tensky. Starix takes down one. Guardian in a terrible 1-on-2 here. And he's going to go down. And that's 15-14. The gamble works. But the thing that I don't get... How did Edward not kill everyone in the middle here?
Yeah, no idea. I think a lot of that round is due to MSL. He's just been playing out of his mind this game, and he's picking up so many important frags for his team. And it's just unreal what kind of an impact he's had so far in this game. And look at Uno IN, no fear.
Rush comes through, great double from Seast. Edward flashes his way in, gonna get the one, and now it's not done yet. Kevin and Tensky left. Now they have to step it up, and just maybe they will. I mean, this should be Na'Vi's round, but the CIS team has just been having some weird, weird retakes where they haven't been able to do it just quite properly yet. Seuss walking in from behind. He should be able to have this. He makes noise for no reason and then pulls out a grenade. That, I just have no explanation for what we just saw. That was a horrible mess. One thing is him making noise, but then pulling out a grenade once you... It's almost like waving a flag saying, I'm right here, and also I don't have my weapon out.
Yeah, it's like when you're playing SM mode in 1.6 and you get that beacon of light around you. That's kind of what Seuss did there.
Yeah, Starix. Now Kevin knows where he is as well. Guardian trying to see if he can peek in. This is not obviously for Navi. Bomb down. Guardian is now alone. He's going to peek right in. And this is not working. Tensky will drop him. And I'm afraid Seuss just threw this game away. That was one of the dumbest things I've seen in a while. 16-14. And Reason or Uno Iron are able to take it. But what a... I don't know. This... it's just not Navi's day, is it?
It was a sloppy...